William Shakespeare wrote Hamlet around the year 1600 as a play about a 15th century prince of Denmark. Hamlet is the longest of Shakespeare's plays, one of the most widely known, and it is still performed frequently. There are many adaptations which have parallels to the plot and themes of Hamlet, such as The Lion King, Sons of Anarchy, The Story of Edgar Sawtelle, and The Black Prince. It is our hope to capture the impact of Hamlet and investigate the views of modern school teachers on Hamlet's relevance in today's curriculum. Our findings are presented in the following documentary. Hamlet was actually based off of the Norse legend created around 1200, written by a man named Saxo Grammaticus. His books, 16 of them in total, were collectively known as The History of the Danes and tell the tales of the rise and fall of Denmark's mighty kings. Shakespeare derives his inspiration for Hamlet from the particular tale of Amleth. In Saxo's version, two brothers, Orvandil and Thingi, are appointed to rule over Jutland in Denmark. Orvandil weds the king of Denmark's beautiful daughter, Geruth, and has a son, who they name Amleth. But the other brother, Thingi, lusting over Orvandil's new bride and longing to become the sole ruler of Jutland, kills his brother Orvandil, marries his wife Geruth, and declares himself king over the land. Amleth is desperately afraid and feigns madness to keep from getting murdered. He plans revenge against his uncle and becomes the new and rightful king of Jutland. This myth was passed on from Saxo Grammaticus to Christian Pedersen, a Danish writer and publisher who published the story of Amleth in 1514. In 1590, English dramatist Thomas Kyd created a reproduction of the play, which later inspired Shakespeare. And thus, Shakespeare immortalized Saxo's legend with the tragic history of Hamlet, Prince of Denmark.
Is it important to learn Shakespeare and why?
Absolutely, it's important to learn Shakespeare. As I was telling some of my sophomores this year as we're dealing with Macbeth, Shakespeare's everywhere. If you want to truly be educated and truly come across as knowing things, you got to know Shakespeare. He's quoted, he's referred to, he's referenced. The only thing more quoted and referenced than him is the Bible. And to truly be an educated person in society, I think you have to know Shakespeare.
I think it's important to study literature, but I don't think there's anything specifically important about Shakespeare.
It puts the English language to the test.
You can survive without knowing Shakespeare. There's a lot of like cultural references that are like from Shakespeare.
I feel like as like a citizen of the world, you should know about Shakespeare. I think it gets referenced so much that you're just kind of out of the loop.
I think that it's always relatable and it's always universal. So it doesn't matter that it's so old, because there is something that anyone on any level can get out of Shakespeare.
He's the greatest writer that ever lived, at least in Western society. His use of the language is amazing, and his abuse of rules and creation of words is amazing. And if he can do it, why can't we? So I think teaching kids is just, it's an important thing. It's a rite of passage too, I think.
Okay. He like really pushed the envelope on like what the English language can do. And previously, like Latin and Greek were considered like the only like high like cultured languages where people could really express their inner feelings and all that stuff. But then like in this stuff, he actually like, I don't know, there's been like a writer since that has actually been able to like make use of as many metaphors and like analogies and everything.
I think it's important to learn Shakespeare because there's no one else that uses words so well as Shakespeare. And so you gotta be exposed to that. You gotta see that.
Yeah, it benefits you. It rounds your education. You understand something more than just the stupidity that's in the media today. And it's just classic words and lines, and it's much more of a beautifully written word than some of the ignorance that we read today.
What do you know about Hamlet?
Hamlet is a tragic story in which people have
tragic endings.
The play set in Denmark, and it was edited several times. Like, he had a different version of the play, and then he reworked the play. And so the version that we read is kind of poignant because he reworked the play after the death of his father and his son. Mm. And all the stuff that goes along with that.
Today we are going to discuss the story of Hamlet. In Act 1, Scene 1, we are introduced to the setting. Guards are outside the palace when they see a ghost they believe to be the late King Hamlet. Claudius, Hamlet's uncle, marries Gertrude, Hamlet's mother. At the wedding, Claudius, the new king, gives Laertes permission to study in France. Horatio then tells Hamlet about the ghost of his father, and he insists on meeting him. Scene 3 focuses around Polonius's family. First, Laertes says goodbye to his family. Then Ophelia talks about her and Hamlet's relationship, gathering advice from her brother Laertes and her father Polonius. The ghost of late King Hamlet appears before Hamlet, Horatio, and the guard. Going against his companion's advice, Hamlet follows the ghost into the woods. The ghost explained the way he died. Claudius poured poison into the ear of the late King Hamlet, but no one knew. They thought he just got bit by a poisonous snake. The ghost tells Hamlet to get revenge on Claudius.
Act 2, Scene 1. Polonius tells someone to check up on Laertes in France. Ophelia rushes in because she has just been visited by an angry Hamlet. Polonius decides he must tell Claudius about Hamlet's behavior. In Scene 2, Fortinbras is first introduced to the play and is set to appear later on. Hamlet greets the actors and later indulges in self-hate after seeing how much more passion the lead actor had in his role than in Hamlet's own life. Hamlet launches the plan to evoke an emotional response from Claudius by setting up a play to mirror his father's murder.
Oh, what a rogue and pleasant slave am I! It is not monstrous that this player here, but in a fiction, in a dream of passion, could force his soul so to his own conceit, that from her working all his visage waned, tears in his eyes, distraction in his aspect, a broken voice, and his whole function suiting with forms to his conceit, and all for nothing, for Hecuba! What's Hecuba to him, or he to Hecuba, that he should weep for her? What would he do had he the motive and the cue for passion that I have? He would drown the stage with tears and cleave the general ear with horrid speech, make mad the guilty and appall the free, confound the ignorant and amaze indeed this very faculties of eyes and ears. Yet I, a dull and muddy-mettled rascal, peek like John o' Dreams, unpregnant of my cause and can say nothing. No, not a king upon whose property and most dear life a damned defeat was made. Am I a coward? Who calls me villain? Breaks my pate across, plucks off my beard and blows it in my face, tweaks me by the nose, gives me the lie of the throat as deep as to the lungs? Who does me this? Ha! Swounds, I should take it, for it cannot be but I am pigeon-livered and lack gall to make oppression bitter. Or ere this, I should have fatted all the region kites with this slave's offal. Bloody, bawdy villain! Remorseless, treacherous, lecherous, kindless villain! Oh, vengeance! Why, what an ass am I! This is most brave that I, the son of a dear father, murdered, prompted to my revenge by heaven and hell, must, like a whore, unpack my heart with words and fall a-cursing like a very drab. A scullion! Fie upon it, foe! About my brains. Hum, I have heard that guilty creatures sitting at a play have, by the very cunning of the scene, been struck so to the soul that presently they have proclaimed their malefactions. For murder, though it have no tongue, will speak with most miraculous organ. I'll have these players play something like the murder of my father before mine uncle. I'll observe his looks. I'll tint him to the quick. If he do blench, I know my course. The spirit that I have seen may be a devil, and the devil hath power to assume a pleasing shape, yeah, and perhaps, out of my weakness and my melancholy, as he is very potent with such spirits, abuse me to damn me. I'll have grounds more relative than this. The play's the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
Act to scene 2, lines 576 to 634, and Hamlet realizes that, you know, some actor with no emotional attachment to characters in a play can put in more, put forth more emotion and effort into a play than Hamlet himself can in, like, avenging his own father's death. Mm-hmm. And so, I think it just really shows, like, how indecisive Hamlet is, and how, like, you know, he kind of just... he's all talk, but, you know, he gets... nothing.
Could you consider it a kind of emotional awakening for Hamlet? Because soon after that, once he realizes how the actors have more emotion than him, people start calling him crazy. Mm-hmm. Like, after that...
Yeah.
He's soon after.
I think this is, like, a gate... Like, I don't know about y'all, but the vibe I got from Hamlet is that he's, like, dissatisfied with himself. Yeah. And I think, like, this is one of the soliloquies that, like, shows that how angry he is with himself. He's not just angry with... Claudius and Gertrude and like other characters.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Hamlet contemplates suicide in the middle of the struggle to punish Claudius. The meeting with Ophelia ends with Hamlet making himself look crazy. And Claudius believes, because of this craziness, Hamlet needs to be killed. Act 3, Scene 2. Hamlet's play, in which he recreates the murder of his father, is performed, freaking out Claudius and raising suspicion. Hamlet decides to visit Gertrude after the play. In Scene 3, Claudius is distraught and agrees to send Polonius to spy on Hamlet. Hamlet catches Claudius praying, but decides not to kill Claudius then, because he should be doing something sinful when he is killed. In Scene 4, Hamlet visits Gertrude and accuses her of all the evil things she's doing, like marrying his uncle. And after finding out that someone has been spying on them through a curtain, Hamlet thinks it's Claudius, but after stabbing the curtain, finds out it's not Claudius, it's Polonius. And then Hamlet's dad's ghost becomes visible only to Hamlet and reminds him to stay focused on the mission of revenge. Hamlet then confides in his mom that he's not actually crazy.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing, end them. To die, to sleep, no more. And by a sleep to say we end, the heartache and a thousand natural shocks. The flesh is heir too, 'tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die to sleep perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come, when we have shuffled off this mortal coil, must give us pause. There's the respect that makes the calamity of so long life, for who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely. The pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns, the patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin, who will at fardels bear, to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dead of something after death, the undiscovered country of whose bourne no traveller returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have, than to fly to others we know not of. Thus conscious does make us cowards of us all, and thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pitch and moment with this regard their currents turn awry, and lose the name of action. Soft you now, the fair Ophelia, nymph, in thy orisons be all my sins remembered.
Act 3, Scene 1, lines 56 to 89, the to be or not to be soliloquy. So basically, just like contemplates like death and suicide. Yeah.
These speeches.
This is very famous, guys.
Yeah.
Gertrude discusses with Claudius about Hamlet killing Polonius, and Claudius sees him as a threat. He decides to send Hamlet to England and tell Rosencrantz and Guildenstern to bring Hamlet to him. Hamlet then disposes of Polonius' body. Then, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern take Hamlet to Claudius. Hamlet discloses the location of Polonius' body and agrees to go to England. Claudius gives a letter to Rosencrantz and Guildenstern ordering the death of Hamlet when they go to England. Hamlet runs into Prince Fortinbras when he's on his way to attack Poland. Hamlet admires Fortinbras' dedication to execute plans and vows to not hesitate on his journey to revenge. Ophelia becomes insane from her father's death, and Gertrude and Claudius try to calm her down. Laertes shows up with a mob and demands his father's body. Hamlet sends a letter to Horatio, explaining that the ship he was on to England got attacked by pirates. Pirates treated him well and are going to take him back to Denmark. Hamlet sends a message to Claudius saying that he will return. This makes Laertes and Claudius happy, and they start planning for Hamlet's death. They decide that Laertes will stab Hamlet with a poison sword, and Claudius will make Hamlet drink from a poison cup. They are interrupted by news that Ophelia has drowned.
Connor just, like, blunders his entire way through the play, right? So, like, he doesn't...
He's
never
really clear in his thought process.
No. Yeah, but it never translates into anything substantial that actually gets done.
Okay. That's just because he's a kid. He doesn't want to kill someone.
I mean, you have Fortinbras and you have Laertes who are both, like, avenging their fathers, and they both get, like, something, though.
Seems kind of odd, but Fortinbras recognizes what Hamlet went through at the end of the play. Mm-hmm. And while he was rattling his saber and feeling like he had been given a raw deal... when he comes through and discovers what Hamlet goes through, he actually gives Hamlet a burial that he probably doesn't deserve in some ways, but one that he gets nonetheless. And so I think Fortinbras is probably my favorite. I'm not a big fan of Hamlet in a lot of ways, but I mean, he does what he has to do.
Do you consider him whiny?
Yeah, but he's also supposed to be like 16 to 19 years old.
Yeah.
And he doesn't shock me as being any different than most teenagers I deal with on a daily basis.
How all occasions do inform against me, and spur my dull revenge. What is a man if his chief good and market of his time be but to sleep and feed? A beast, no more. Sure, he that made us with such large discourse, looking before and after, gave us not that capability and godlike reason to fust in us unused. Now, whether it be bestial oblivion or some craven scruple of thinking too precisely on the event, a thought which, quartered, hath but one part wisdom, and even three parts coward, I do not know. Why yet I live to say this thing's to do, sith I have cause and will and strength and means to do it, examples gross as earth exhort me, witness this army of such mass and charge, led by a delicate and tender prince, whose spirit with divine ambition puffed makes mouths at the invisible event, exposing what is mortal and unsure to all that fortune, death, and danger dare, even for an eggshell. Rightly to be, great is not to stir without great argument, but greatly to find quarrel in a straw when honor's at the stake. How stand I, then, that have a father killed, a mother stained, excitements of my reason and my blood, and let all sleep, while to my shame I see the imminent death of 20,000 men, that for a fantasy and trick of fame go to their graves like beds, fight for a plot whereon the numbers cannot try the cause, which is not tomb enough and continent to hide the slain. Oh, from this time forth my thoughts be bloody or be nothing worth.
Act 4, Scene 4, lines 32 to 66. And this is where Hamlet runs into Fortinbras, and he's like, "Oh, like you can, you can do all these things. You have this big army, and like I can't even kill my own father or my own uncle."
Well, that pretty much says it.
Well, I mean, like you have Fortinbras, who's like waging war on some like insignificant piece of land that like doesn't matter to anyone. And then you have Hamlet, who's like, I don't know, it's like kind of a pretty big deal to like avenge your father, but like, you know.
I think Hamlet started to build an appreciation for actions instead of thoughts, because he's starting to be aware of what he can and can't do, or what he at least has or hasn't done. And so I think this is why Fortinbras is kind of a big character, even though he's not present at all. Because of that kind of awareness of actions are definitely bigger than words.
Yeah, it's a contrast between like what Fortinbras does and what Hamlet does. Mm-hmm.
I think it leads to the ultimate decision of Hamlet giving Fortinbras
the
state of Denmark.
He like holds him up on a pedestal and he's like, oh my gosh, you're so much greater than I am. Mm-hmm.
If you had to pick one major theme of the play, what do you think it would be?
Revenge.
The idea of having to seek revenge and to the point of murder, I think that would be the extreme. That would be the Jodi Picoult novel version. But the real world scenario is we have to figure out why we have had bad things happen to us and how to keep going, and we contemplate that.
I definitely think reading Shakespeare, especially Hamlet, like helps you form your ideas on certain big topics like suicide and revenge.
Hamlet has an encounter with two clowns, or gravediggers, and is shocked by the carelessness they treat life with. He finds the skull of Yorick, his former jester, and feels distraught that his clear friend had passed.
There's another. Why may not that be the skull of a lawyer? Where be his quiddities now? His qualities, his cases, his tenures, and his tricks. Why does he suffer this mad knave now to knock him about the sance with a dirty shovel and will not tell him of action of battery? This fellow might be in times a great buyer of land, with his statutes, his recognizances, his fines, his double vouchers, his recoveries. Is this the fine of his fines and the recovery of his recoveries? To have the fine plate full of fine dirt? Will his vouchers vouch him no more of his purchases, and double ones too, than the length and breadth of a pair of indentures? The very conveyances of his lands will scarcely lie in this box, and must the inheritor himself have no more. Ha.
It's a continuation of his whole thoughts about death, his train of thought about death. I find it weird that he goes from, I could commit suicide, and I kind of want to, but religion's kind of stopping me, to more of a materialistic on earth point of view, mm-hmm. to where like, oh, this is the dead person's skull. He has no more thoughts about a soul. It's just skull and the dust of a skull being put into walls and what the earthly remains do. I don't know what that kind of development means for Hamlet, and I'm not sure what Shakespeare meant by it.
Well, he started kind of like as an introvert, and like that was probably most of his problem was that like he wasn't one to be like a prince that like obeys his duties. So like as he went along, he started like trying to emulate all these extroverted like leaders that like actually took action. But it didn't really work out well for him because he's not used to living that kind of lifestyle. But towards the end, he like starts being obsessed with like his legacy and like what it means to be a king and what makes a good king.
The royal family comes to bury Ophelia, but Hamlet is there to confront Laertes, and they square off as a result, agreeing to settle the issue later at the plea of others. Hamlet accepts a duel with Laertes in the middle of his discussion with Horatio about how he let Rosencrantz and Guildenstern get executed in England. Even though he knows it is most likely a trap, Hamlet accepts his fate and he lets whatever happens happen. In his duel, he gets swiped by Laertes' poisoned blade and in exchange and swipes back with the same sword. Meanwhile, Gertrude drinks from a poisoned chalice and dies. After learning that Claudius is behind everything, Hamlet forces him to drink from the poisoned chalice, thereby killing him. After they all die, Fortinbras arrives and takes control of the country with Hamlet's consent. The end.
So, we should
talk about like Hamlet's development, how he starts really mopey. But then, like,
he ends really, really. No. He ends really, really mopey too.
How does he end mopey?
No, he ends like okay with his mopiness.
No, because he looks at Fortinbras and he's like, "Oh, you're so great, and like I suck, and I still haven't gotten anything done."
Because he's dying.
He finds resolution.
Yeah. He just like I feel like he gets less like angry as the play goes on. Like at first he's very, very angry, and then towards the end he's like, oh well, I guess I can't really do anything about it now, oh well, like I just failed.
But he doesn't have a plan.
Well, I think he's less mopey the moment in Act 4 whenever he says, hey, I'm gonna go out for blood now, I'm tired of this. I think that's kind of when he turns and he's less of a whiny kid and more of like the, you know, the person who dies out. No, I think one of the big themes in Hamlet's kind of like finding yourself, you know, figuring out who, like deciding on who you want to be.
As cheesy as it sounds, I guess he did it originally. It's like the human journey of like,
how did Hamlet find himself?
Well, he had a bunch of anguish over like what his position as like a prince and like if he's entitled to serve his father still or if he's like.
I don't think he like resolved like finding himself. I definitely think he went on a journey of trying to find himself, but I don't think he at the end I just felt unsatisfied with the result of like how much he progressed, I guess.
Well, I mean, like he found like a purpose, I guess, in like finding revenge, but it was really short term and like really like nearsighted. Like it wasn't gonna do anything for him in the long run.
I think now I look at more like Hamlet's struggle with himself and Hamlet's struggle with expectations that are put on him by a parent who happens to be a ghost parent.
I think he has that point where he's like, oh, well, everyone, like, no matter how great you are, like, you die and then you end up, like, nothing. So he's kind of just like, well, if everyone dies, like, my father died, so, like, Claudius is probably going to die. And, like, you know, what's, like, the point of this whole thing when, like, everyone's just going to die?
People do that.
Well, I mean, because he wants Claudius dead, but, like, in the end, Claudius is going to die from something. So I think he's kind of just like, is this whole plot even worth it anymore?
I think anybody can relate to the existential crises that Hamlet goes through, because there's always a point in time where you have to figure out who you are and what you're going to do.
Hamlet's soliloquies are all, what is this life and what is a human being and what are we doing? And he's upset about it. And he's just expressing that. And that's what I think the bottom line is.
When I was a kid, and when we went to school, we had to make the Globe Theater. It was a project. We spent a month with Shakespeare, and we made the Globe Theater.